With the passing of her beloved mother Dee Dee in 1977 and then the death from cancer of Vivian Vance in 1979 set the tone for the last decade of Lucille Ball's life. She turned to husband Gary Morton for that love and attention she seemed to need so badly from her mother. But by now, Gary had become a man of means himself, busy with friends in high places, and his all-abiding interest in golf seemed to keep him away from home more and more. It was during this time that Lucille chanced upon a board game called backgammon that would become a passion for the rest of her life and through which she would try to keep her loneliness at bay. After her accident on the slopes of Aspen Snowmass in 1971, she had broken her leg in four places, and though doctors had repaired it as best as they could, she could not indulge in the physical activities she had so enjoyed, like bicycling, horse riding, tennis, or skiing. The wear and tear of showbiz career, all the hectic, strenuous actions she seemed to have done so easily then, were now exacting a price. The dislocated shoulder in her early years now turned into permanent bursitis. The dental work of those far-off days came back to haunt her, with frequent toothaches and constant smoking gave her high blood pressure. She had been known to be a very private person, so going out did not appeal to her all that much. Also because crowds gave her panic attacks. In this scenario, it made sense to have friends come over for company and play games of backgammon while not having to leave the safety of her home. To this end, a lot of people began congregating around the slowing but still feisty icon of the show world. Intentionally or unintentionally, Gary's relatives now seemed to monopolize her time and attention. With Gary's rise in fortune, his family members did not lag behind in claiming a piece of the pie, so to say. From their humble beginnings in the Bronx, his mother and sister now lived in upmarket condos in upscale areas of Los Angeles. Gary's sister Helen often visited her rich sister-in-law, ostensibly to play backgammon, but no doubt to keep an eye on things. Her son was a part of the household staff, and Sid Gould, another relative, had been a permanent fixture in Lucy's shows. But the most damage done to the revered idol of millions after her death was a distant relative, Lee Tannen, who gained entry into the Morton household through Helen. He had been biding his time, and then, when Lucille was sick, aging and demoralized and leading a retired life in the comfort of a luxurious home in Beverly Hills, probably nudged by Helen, he evinced a keen desire to make his acquaintance with the queen of comedy. This sudden interest to gatecrash the party at this late stage smacks of an opportunistic motive, but Lucille had no option but to be civil, as she was to all of Gary's relatives, not wishing to offend the husband she depended on so much. Perhaps his New York savvy and his witty remarks sealed the deal for Tannen, and he was invited to be a part of some of the activities of his famous hostess. Tannen quickly began ingratiating himself to the simple, unassuming senior citizen by playing her favorite backgammon games and pretending to watch all the Lucy show tapes carefully stored in the house. But after the publication of a wholly undocumented, unauthorized book on her, written after her death, it is clear that his was not the caring, concerned attention of a well-wisher, but the malicious, peeping Tom actions of an intruder towards an unsuspecting victim. When Lucille moved for a while to New York to be close to her grandchildren, Tannen and his partner were at her beck and call all the time, much to the relief of Gary, who could leave his wife in their care while he pursued his own interests. Under the guise of keeping Lucille amused, Tannen paraded his charge around New York and gained publicity and reflected glory from the many celebs she knew and who revered her. He himself writes in his book that during the time Lucille expelled him from her life, he found his newfound fame drying up and people stopped quoting him like before. The reason for his being banned from the Morton household was a confrontation between the two when Tannen, like a jealous lover, threw a hissy fit over Lucille's friendship with Paula Stewart, her co-star in the Wildcat musical. Only an upstart like him could assume he had a say in the huge celeb's choice of friends, especially someone Lucille cared so much about because she had introduced her to Gary. As it is, her move to New York was a huge disappointment to Lucille, whose relationship with her daughter remained on the same warring path as before. Tannen's tantrums, on the other hand, upset her so much that she made up her mind to return to the safety and congeniality of her Hollywood neighborhood. Often celebs encounter the menace of such persistent hangers-on who are attracted by their fame and popularity in the course of their lives. And though Lucille succeeded in banishing him for a few years, in time, Tannen wormed his way back into her good graces with the help, I'm guessing, of his old ally Helen, and continued to take advantage of her hospitality from time to time. Self-centered and vain person that he was, in his book written on her, he presents himself as the apple of Lucille Ball's eye. He presents himself as the apple of Lucille Ball's eyes, who was a clingy, adoring admirer, always worried about his welfare. When the fact of the matter was, Lucille Ball was extremely aware and wary of the AIDS epidemic raging through Hollywood at this time. Among many other celebs, Rock Hudson had become a victim of the dread disease. At that time, there was a misconception that the disease only affected homosexuals. Being extremely cautious and clued in, when she asked about his health, it may have been a very real concern about the safety of her own household. At a time when gay people were being shunned by society, Lucille was, as usual, going against the grain by inviting a couple of gay men to her home and lugging them around with her to the various events and tributes accorded to her. And so Lee Tannen and his partner became the unlikely partners in crime of a generous-hearted, loyal mentor who took them places they could never dream of, and more importantly, may not have been welcome had their sexual orientation been revealed. The grand hotels of New York or the army bases where she went to entertain the troops with Bob Hope, or the biggest of them all, the White House, where the two tagged along when her own children dropped out at the last moment, may have been barred to them if the towering personality of Lucille Ball had not swept away all doubts and misgivings on the part of their hosts. Nearly 30 years later, it is politically correct to speak up passionately about LGBT rights. But back then, people avoided such conversations and the gay community belonged more or less in the closet. So, what Lucille Ball did for Lee Tannen should have evoked a lasting gratitude, but what did result instead was a book, a peeping through the keyhole type of scurrilous innuendo and gossip compilation. It's an attempt to take advantage of his fleeting encounters with a famous person to claim unverified incidents which try to sully her pristine reputation. When asked at a question and answer session why people write nasty things about celebs, she promptly answered, to sell their books or magazines. When asked if she regretted being a celebrity, she thought for a while and then said, yes, when people write mean things about you or click the worst pictures, then. Tannen's book would have been a heartwarming, funny book if it had been based on facts, but with its obvious untruths and insinuations, it should be proclaimed to be a work of fiction, a figment of his fertile imagination, written to earn a lot of money and an act of treachery to someone who had displayed her aversion to such unauthorized books many times in her lifetime. Moreover, lazy writer that he is, Tennant's book, I Loved Lucy, is like the barely tweaked title, just a compilation of scenes from the different Lucille movies and Lucille shows, which he has connected to imaginary happenings in the famous comedian's life, in his presence to boot. Let's take them up one by one, just for the fun of exposing his farce. When he writes about welcoming her in the lobby of a crowded hotel, he says he felt like the young boy Patrick in Mame, welcoming Auntie Mame. When he describes an incident when Lucille supposedly fainted when no one else was around and he carried her to her bed, he says he felt like Little Pink carrying Her Highness up the stairs, like in the film Big Street. When he happened to be in the car that Lucille was driving, he says he felt like Ricky Ricardo giving his wife driving lessons, perhaps forgetting that she had been driving from a very early age and often drove herself to a studio for a taping session even in the late 1980s, as described by a more sincere fan, Michael Stern. He describes his outrage at her taking out a powder compact to powder her nose during movie shows. I wonder what he finds so scandalizing about it. Why would anybody bother about a simple act which is routine for most women? Unless he felt he should have been invited to share the powder. In another real life meets real life incident, he claims Lucille, the epitome of poise and dignity, stood outside her Hollywood home in the night yelling, "Bye bye baby," like the famous "Bye bye baby" routine Lucille did with Carol Burnett on the latter's show. Then he claims he had a mother-son relationship with Lucille because she was estranged from her son Desi Jr. The fact of the matter was that at the very time Tennant crash-landed in the Morton household, both Lucille Ball and Desi Sr. were desperately trying to wean Desi Jr. away from his addictions, and for that both attended the therapy sessions of the de-addiction center he was enrolled in. In fact, for moral support, Desi Sr. also got himself enrolled for the course, though he couldn't keep it up for long. Desi Jr. was the love of her life, as is evident from the password games they both appeared in the late 1980s. When he was brought on a Johnny Carson show as a surprise for the guest of honor Lucille Ball, she jumps up in delight and an endearing mother-son love fest follows.
They wouldn't come to me with that because they're beyond that. They know that that's prostitution and they wouldn't do it. And they don't need they don't need it. I feel sorry for the young people that do need it because they're being exploited. Don't look at me like
I'm agreeing with you.
Well, I hope so.
This is not a string. I actually can do this.
I think that the young people are being exploited that are a little hungry. Don't laugh at him. Don't make him think that he's saying the right thing all the time. Have a stern face occasionally.
Yes, I will.
No, I think you're right.
No, it's serious. I'm very serious about it because they are being exploited. There are porno jobs around for people who think they have to work. They'd rather, work than be an unemployed actor. I'd rather be an unemployed gas employee, or that's the wrong thing to say right now, isn't
it?
But anyway, my kids would not come and ask that question because they would know the answer.
Well, that's interesting. That's what I wanted to know.
Yeah.
What?
Here's your son. Yes, yes. You're not going to get away with that. Coming over to my seat and leaving. Thank you.
I don't know. I just wrote it out.
We've been hoping you'd come home for a long time, son.
I thought
Had ads in the papers and everything.
Have you been hurt in the war?
What? What are you talking about? The
what
cane?
Is this?
No, it means nothing.
I thought.
Oh, leave it alone.
I thought you had something.
Huh?
No, I thought you really had something wrong.
So
no, well, actually, I do, but it's an old injury, a football injury, and every time the weather acts up, my knee kind of acts
21.
Up.
He's 21. Look at the old.
What do you mean, old football injury? It's like my old war injury. I have this piece of shrapnel.
Yeah.
That I picked up in my back.
What was your last name?
Wait. You're right, it happened in St. Louis, as a matter of fact. Hotel
Fine. Hey, you found time to come over here and say hello to your old, poor
sure
old mother,
did.
Huh?
I'm doing Lampoon right next door.
Well, that's
don't
a new
be
show
pushing another show.
Well, that's why I came over, actually.
Oh!
No, I
came haven't
over.
Seen you in weeks. That's why you came over.
Why don't you ever write?
That's true.
That's what my mother always says.
Oh, well, you've been away.
49
I've been
years
here.
Old.
I've been working,
be
but you've been away going all over the country with the movie.
Have you seen the picture
and I want
yet?
To congratulate you. No, I haven't seen the movie yet.
See?
No, but I saw... what do you mean, see? All of a sudden, everybody's picking on me.
Well, you were invited to the preview. Where were you?
I was working. I have things to do.
Mothers
I
never change, do they? Where were you? You were invited.
Have you taken care of yourself?
Yes, I have. I've been working very hard. I'm doing the thing over with Schlatter, and I'm doing another show on another network that we don't want to get into.
The rash clear up all right? I don't know. I'm just trying to get in here.
Johnny, jump in anytime.
I just want to feel like a father.
Jump in anytime.
I just want to know one thing. With whom are you in love today?
No one. Only you.
Does she Thank ask you. About...
Well, I...
She had a close bond with her son, who, unlike his sister, was probably... not at loggerheads with her all the time and was casually indulgent to her efforts to do things for him, like picking up his bed sheets, as Stern reveals in his book. Far from being estranged from Desi Jr., after he was able to straighten out his life with his parents' help, his mother was looking forward to his marriage with Linda Pearl, which Tannen does not mention in his book, nor his marriage to Amy in the late 1980s, with whom he stayed happily married till her death by cancer. So if Tannen wasn't part of such important events of the family, perhaps he wasn't her blue-eyed boy after all, as he claims to be. Bordering on the absurd, Tannen claims that Lucille decided to shift to New York to be near him and his endearing ways, I guess, when that well-documented move was made in the mid-1980s after the mother, Lucille Ball, felt overwhelmed by emotions when her children sang a song as a tribute to their mother at an event to honor her.
This is one of the most recognized faces in the world. Just a glimpse it provokes affection and has for 50 years. And now, with her husband, film producer Gary Morton, the 72-year-old, shapely, flaming-haired grandmother has moved to New York City, preferring the billing of businesswoman, wife, and mother to that of living legend. But no matter where she hangs her many hats, loving Lucy continues to be a universal pastime.
I'm still making people laugh with the same shows, but I miss working in front of an audience. I miss having a place, an arena. I miss the steady work. I miss the fun of taking a script from the beginning and watching it come to life. I loved it.
When you think about yourself, how do you identify the inner you, as wife and mother or as actress and comedian?
I think it's always been wife and mother first. And for a while it was mother, 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 mother. And then back to wife, mother.
Are you pleased with the way your children have turned out?
Oh, yes. And my grandchildren. They're turning out pretty good, too. I did the Hall of Fame recently and Lucy sang a song that put me away, and my son said some very nice things, and it's really wonderful when they take the time to say they care and appreciate and that they really learn.
Somehow you seem to make getting older the easiest, most natural thing in the world. What's the secret to that?
I never think about age. I don't know how old anybody is. I really don't. I have to stop and think how old my children are. My life really started when my children was born. I always have said that, and I meant it.
You have worked hard all your life. Now, is leisure coming easy to you, or has it been an adjustment?
I depend on Gary a lot now, even more than I should. I'm enjoying it. I'd never really had anyone that I could really depend on for fun and for everything. And I probably do too much of that with him, but I hope he doesn't mind.
Ready to grasp at straws, she thought her constantly feuding daughter was at last ready for a reconciliation and decided to shift to New York to be near the grandchildren she adored. Of course, it was a mirage of epic proportions. Lucy Arnaz was as belligerent as ever, and her mother returned to Beverly Hills an embittered woman, her return also induced by the disrespectful behavior of Lee Tannen, which upset her horribly. But the height of treachery shown by Tannen was when he sought to cast aspersions on his benefactress' integrity by claiming to link an incident in her life to, as usual, episodes in the Lucy shows. He claimed in his book that during her stay in a New York hotel, Lucille pinched some cutlery from her suite for her own apartment, which he had to spirit away for her in a pillow cover. Now Paula Stewart, who was mostly present with them during this time, refutes this version entirely in her book Lucy Loved Me and says it was the gay couple who thought of the idea, and Lucille, very much mindful of her standing and reputation, stopped the outrage. Now would Lucille Ball risk her image being tarnished for a few forks and knives? And since Tannen himself says both Paula and Lucille spent hours shopping for the new apartment, would the hugely rich diva who was fastidious to a fault care to furnish a new home, which was photographed later on by a prestigious home magazine with mismatched flatware, when she had spent a fortune buying up every other accessory? This was something the not-so-well-off homies, who had probably never gained entry to such a luxurious hotel before in their lives, would do. In fact, Tannen himself tells of an incident when he wanted to carry some caviar and an expensive bottle of champagne from Lucille's house to their Palm Springs getaway. But when she refused his request, he carted it off anyway to be enjoyed with his partner. But Tannen got the inspiration to pin the cutlery pinching accusation on Lucille from two Lucy shows. In the episode where Viv and Lucy go to Las Vegas in the Lucy show, both friends pick up the free food from the lobby along with the plates and spoons and drop them in the bags. In the show, here's Lucy. In the episode where Donny Osmond is a guest star, Lucy gathers up all the items from the hotel tables and slips them in her bag. I think Tannen boned up on the Lucy shows before turning up at her home so as to be able to impress her with his fan status. Who knows how much of his narcissistic claims actually happened. But a telling point of her generosity is, after she left New York, she gave away all the furniture in the apartment to her niece, Fred Ball's daughter. The whole purpose of bringing out this book was to lampoon Lucille and shred her privacy to bits. She, who always believed that fans and public should never be exposed to the negative aspects of their idols, had her private conversations and viewpoints splashed in a tell-all book after her death. Tannen was able to conjure up this book of salacious gossip due to the authorization of it by Lucy Arnaz, who is ever eager to expose her mother, warts and all. The more warts, the better for her. Consistently and tirelessly, this resentful daughter has badmouthed her mother every chance she gets. Much to her chagrin, interviewers are only interested in talking about her famous mother and not about her own importance. So despite the huge Lucy empire she rules over and the luxurious lifestyle she and her children are able to afford thanks to her mother, not a word of gratitude ever escapes her lip. Perhaps Gary Morton dealt the biggest blow to Lucille Ball's self-esteem and pride in the last years of her life. From an obliging, humble partner of the 1960s and 1970s, he had slowly but surely transformed into a high-stepping man about town, who had amassed a sizable fortune of his own thanks to the Lucy shows and had seen to it that his family members were well provided for. In short, he did not need to be too mindful of the famous Ball temper from a much weakened and demoralized wife anymore. Of course, he took care not to push boundaries and made a great show of being caring and respectful in public. Perhaps Gary took pains to keep her happy and contented by siding with her in the clashes over salty food, drinks, and smoking between herself and her doctors and nurses. If there's one thing the headstrong Lucille could not have abided by were the instructions to cut down on her smoking or the salt in her favorite Chinese food or the alcoholic beverages, which she insisted were in moderation. By the time Lucille turned 70 years, she was past her prime, ill, frail, and grieving the death of her mother and her friend Vivian Vance.
No different from any other well-meaning person right now, I'm sure.
When I was watching this movie, it was difficult to suddenly see you. You very rarely like people to take your picture, and I was curious how you were going to react to people seeing you as a bag lady, in which many times, if it weren't for your voice, it doesn't look like the Lucy we know.
It sure doesn't, I hope. Playing a bag lady didn't bother me. I've looked worse than some of the comedy things that I did. I had a few wishes about her, not so that she wouldn't be stealing and she wouldn't be digging in just any old garbage can. I wanted her to be vulnerable, feisty, and capable of taking care of herself, and she was a loner.
Hey, crazy lady, what you got in there?
We shot all over New York, out of doors, and no one recognized me.
What did that do to you, Lucy?
Left me alone to think of the character. I loved it.
But on another level, you really cannot walk anywhere in the world.
Didn't bother me.
It really didn't.
No, I thought it was very good that the character was there and working for me.
Do you ever have any regrets about your legendary status?
Regrets about my legendary status? I have to think what that means. Regrets about my legend. What is my legendary status?
I mean, you are a bigger than life person, and are there moments when you have ever said, perhaps I just wished I was the little girl from the neighborhood that I came from who never became the famous legendary Lucille Ball?
No, I'm very, I think I have a barometer for that, and that's the way my mother was so pleased. She never missed a show, so I knew how much they meant to her. She brought all of her friends. She was very upset at me when I quit work. What'll I do, Thursday? What'll I do with all my friends? I think the way my mother felt answers that for me. I saw the pleasure that it gave her, and I missed it very much when she was gone. It was a big, big difference then. I wasn't so aware of pleasing one person all the time.
Lucy will be giving more pleasure to audiences later this month in Florida. She'll be in Clearwater, Sarasota, and Pensacola with her seminar, which deals in depth with her career and her philosophy of comedy. Mary?
This was the time she needed the companionship of Gary the most. But by this time, Gary had discovered new friends and pursuits, and from all accounts was seldom home, which is why his sister and the assortment of relatives were foisted on her to keep her busy with backgammon games and provide the company she always craved. But in one way, he was a solicitous husband in that he was alert to any offers made to his wife. As vice president of Lucille Ball Productions, his overriding concern where her career was concerned was what his share of the would be. No profit for Gary, no deal with his wife, seemed to be his abiding philosophy from here on. Unfortunately for Lucille Ball, Unlike Desi Arnaz, Morton ended up making many wrong choices for his wife and her career. When she had more or less lost the will to take any interest in her career or her business, that left Gary to negotiate deals on her behalf, and mostly the only merit in these deals were monetary. Compared to this Shylock, Desi Arnaz was generous and compassionate. He did not contest their divorce, nor the division of their assets, nor the custody of the children, thus sparing her any more negative publicity. So no wonder, towards the end of her life, she became sentimental about their life together, remembering only the good times. When Gary persuaded his wife to play a bag lady in the TV film Stone Pillow, she may have been convinced to get out of her comfort zone and play a de-glamorized part for a good cause, i.e. for the sake of making a social statement for old deprived people. Though it took a heavy toll on her health, and apart from breaking a few tendons in her hand, had to be hospitalized as well. The monumental effort on her part did not measure up to expectations, and all she got were bad reviews for the shallow portrayal of the subject at hand. But the worst was yet to come. Though she had declared upteen times that she had no desire to reprise the role of her Lucy character, somehow Gary managed to persuade her to embark on another Lucy outing called Life with Lucy, this time on NBC Network. Getting an ill-aged octogenarian to play a role which relied on physical comedy to get the laughs was the most cruel thing Morton could have done. In the short-lived show, she was a pathetic picture of dejection and frustration, a caricature of her former feisty self, unable to entertain her fans with the energetic antics of old. Who but the most selfish of people could expose the venerable icon to the barbs and taunts of an unforgiving press and the public, ridicule and humiliation week after week? From many points, it is clear that at this point in her life, Lucille Ball totally relied on her husband for business advice and fell in with his plans resignedly, if not very happily.
Is there an element of security in having people like Gail work with you?
I think, well, Gail was the only one, really, that I was rather insistent about. I didn't want to do it without him. Vivian would still be with us. It would be Vivian and Gail, you know? But I wouldn't want to have even started without Gail.
You mentioned Vivian.
Yeah.
Would you ever consider doing another show with, because I'm assuming that that Lucy is going to go on forever. That's what we're all assuming and hoping. Would you ever consider doing another show with a woman?
No, sir.
When?
She was the best. No, I can think of working with Gail. But not the other way around. I just can't imagine it.
When you hear Lucy talk about Vivian and the times they share, when she talks about Gail, you know that she's talking about friendship. In the foreword to a book called Loving Lucy, Gail Gordon wrote the words that say it best.
Mainly, dear heart, my thanks for letting me participate in a very small way in concocting the world's most needed tonic, laughter, the miracle drug. It's good for what ails you, it has no injurious after effects, and it is well nigh impossible to take an overdose. The world loves you, dear physician. You have soothed our aches and pains, you have lightened our burdens, made our lives a little brighter. You have given television an added dimension by using it as a vehicle for making house calls. Bless you.
Maybe the Big Red was too tired and depleted to fight anymore, and drawing on some secret reserves of stamina, gamely tried to weave a final Lucy magic for her fans. All to no avail. The ratings dipped steadily and the unthinkable happened. Her show was cancelled by the network after just a few episodes, and Lucille retired to her bedroom to come to terms with her well-publicized humiliation. This time, the rejection seemed final, and she could not think beyond the abandonment of her admirers at this late stage in life. In Love, Lucy, she explained why actors take criticism so personally. "We have nothing but ourselves to offer. Rejection can't be anything but personal," she said. As if this wasn't enough, Desi Sr. succumbed to his illness now, and Lucille Ball's misery was complete. During these despondent times, the only thing which cheered her up was the Kennedy Center honors bestowed in the White House by the president himself.
When Joe Louis and Lucille Ball came to entertain the troops, they did different things. He was the heavyweight champion of the world, a kid out of Detroit, who destroyed the invincible symbol of Nazism in one round. Him I knew of. But Lucille Ball? I thought she was just another tall, leggy, willowy, beautiful showgirl. But that she was also a superb clown of infinite range was not known to me until that moment. In the early days at RKO, Lucy would say yes to almost any part. She would have swept the stage if that was the only way she could get on it. 15 years later, she owned the studio. Then along came TV. A lot of people told her, "Don't do it, Lucy, don't do it. It's a dead end." But Lucy said, "Let me at it." And at last, it was the perfect role. They let Lucy be Lucy. Every time she said, "Ethel, I got an idea," we knew what was going to happen next. She was the incurable schemer and dreamer who had bad luck. But it was her luminous innocence that always prevailed. There was no dream she wouldn't reach for, and no fall she wouldn't take. Her side-splitting buffoonery was carved into her bone marrow by an exquisite understanding of the tragic sense of life, which she has turned into a delicious celebration. Job she could to stay in New York and keep trying. Modeling led to a national ad, which led to Hollywood. From a minor showgirl, she progressed through a variety of miscast parts and stock Hollywood types in grade B movies. Taking every job that came her way, Lucy was going nowhere.
We present Lucille Ball in My Favorite Husband.
Then a successful radio series prompted the infant medium of television to ask her to try a domestic comedy. But executives found preposterous her idea to co-star with her Cuban band leader husband. So they took their act on the road. Success convinced a reluctant network to give them a chance. And what a chance it was.
Now you pick up the bottle.
Oh.
A little higher. That's right.
The answer to all your problems is in this little bottle. Vitamita Vegemin. Vitamita Vegemin contains vitamins, meat, vegetables, and minerals. Yes, with Vitamita Vegemin, you can spoon your way to health. All you do is take a tablespoonful after every meal.
Now you take some.
Oh. It's so tasty, too.
The girl who couldn't get Hollywood to make her a star now took television and made it her own. And an entire nation awaited the birth of her son.
Ricky, this is it.
Every Monday at 9, all America stopped to laugh. She created the standards against which other comedians would have to be measured. Her three series continue to be shown in 78 countries. She is the world's most celebrated female clown. In her spare time, she starred in feature films and Broadway musicals. Like the great stars of silent films, she creates a sublime balance between comedy and feeling. Lucy.
With the part of Elliot Ness in The Untouchables, I can remember the lady sitting up there, sitting in the front office. She was the boss. The boss, she owned the studio. But it was her partner who persuaded me that I should do the show. He said, "We're going to make the best dumb television show on television." He wanted to be here tonight. I'd like to read something that he wrote. "I love Lucy at just one mission, to make people laugh. Lucy gave it a rare quality. She can perform the wildest, even the messiest physical comedy without losing her feminine appeal. The New York Times asked me to divide the credit for its success between the writers, the directors, and the cast. I told them, give Lucy 90% of the credit and divide the other 10% among the rest of us. Desi concluded, Lucy was the show. Viv and Fred and I were just props. Damn good props, but props nevertheless. P.S. I Love Lucy was never just a title." As long as you remember that you established a place in television for women. And there are some here tonight that have flown all the way out from Hollywood to pay respects to you. Ladies and gentlemen, the Golden Girls, Bea Arthur. And my sister Sam, Pam Dauber. And Valerie Harper.
We love Lucy, you know we do. We love Lucy, and so do you.
We love that bright antenna.
It sends vibrations to our antenna.
Watch reruns of her each night. To be sure that we do it right.
A lesson for us all is Miss Lucille Ball,
who's mastered every comedy trick. Lucy, on top of every comedy stick.
Lucy, she plans a simple outing together with her neighbor Ethel Merton.
Before you know, they're shouting, and all of us are laughing till it hurts.
The screen, the television, the stage.
Lucy,
you've earned a place on history's page.
Lucy, for what you've done for women, we think you know exactly how we feel.
Baby while on the air was quite a famous first.
She's been nursing yesteries throughout all the years. We all agree she sure deserves a care.
The viewers who memorize every line of every single show are all shouting, Lucy, way to go.
President Reagan was considered one of their own by the film fraternity, and he always reciprocated with a lot of warmth and affection. Held just 2 days after Desi Arnaz's passing, Lucille Ball was particularly vulnerable, but seemed gratified at the show of admiration and affection by the hundreds gathered to honor her. Maybe this unconditional show of solidarity reassured the old veteran actress of a place in the hearts of her loyal fans at last. Some of the disappointment at the Life with Lucy fiasco may have been diminished by this ultimate accolade for her talent and contributions to the world of showbiz. She returned to her lair in Hollywood to take up her backgammon games again. She still enjoyed her trips to the snowy slopes of Snowmass, flying in her private Learjet plane in style. Such was her popularity that in the evenings the patrol team would shout at her window, "Good night, Lucy," before leaving the slopes for the night. She loved seeing the colorful dots of little children playing in the snow from her window. Little penguins, she called them. Gary was conspicuous by his absence on these trips. He had stopped making compromises for her a while ago. She still did not refuse to show up for many of Bob Hope's shows and delighted the audience with a rousing rendition of Hey Look Me Over whenever called upon to do so. In public, she always seemed to summon her reserves of energy and stamina to put up a spirited show for her audience till the very end. In 1988, at age 77, she put up a flawless performance, singing and dancing to the poignant song Comedy Ain't No Joke. In a short tuxedo and leotards, showing her still shapely legs, she was the tall, slim, graceful showgirl of old, not missing a beat, totally in sync with her young backup dancers.
Miss Lucille Ball.
So you think that it's fun to be funny, just a barrel of laughs night and day, in a world that's eternally sunny, with a life that's no work and all play. Just because we can make it look easy doesn't mean it's a carousel ride. So we cackle and crow and go on with the show, although we are dying inside. Comedy is a serious business. Comedy is an art. Comedy is a matter of miming and timing and playing a part. When you're frantically trying to please, sweating bullets and down on your knees, and you see your career disappearing in smoke, comedy ain't no joke. Slide on a slippery banana. You can walk into walls with a splat. You can smoke an exploding Havana. You can fall on what we call a prat. You can cry like a strident coyote and run wild in a riotous chase. You can go out and kill them with polish and skill and still get in the face.
Let me have it.
On the
ball?
No, let me have it. A test.
Comedy
is a grin ear to ear, even when you're severely depressed. It is making them laugh till they cry. It's the pit and the ultimate high. It's the art of pretending, couldn't care less. A light-hearted laugh when your life is a mess. It means go for the goal when you're going for broke. Comedy ain't no joke.